Welcome in this new feature of the week video. Today I will explain how standard errors are calculated in monoliths using stochastic approximation. Standard errors represent the uncertainty of the estimated population parameters. They can, for instance, be used to calculate confidence intervals or detect model overparameterization. In monoliths, they are calculated via the estimation of the Fisher information matrix, and they are given in particular in the table of population estimates. Other methods have been proposed to estimate the standard errors, such as bootstrapping, which is available via our RSMLX package. To know more about this package, you can click on the link at the top of the video. Let me first explain what the observed Fisher information matrix is. The Fisher information matrix is defined as minus the second derivative with respect to the population parameters theta of the log likelihood. It is a function of theta. If it is not clear for you what the likelihood is in monoliths, have a look at the video whose link appears on the top of this video. Monoliths actually calculate the observed Fisher information matrix, which is evaluated at the maximum likelihood estimate called theta hat. It may also be seen as the curvature of the support curve, which is a graph of the log likelihood with respect to the population parameter values theta at the location of the maximum likelihood estimate. This figure shows an example for a simple shape of support curve in one dimension, but remember that this support curve is multidimensional if there are several population parameters in the model. The slope of the support curve is called the score. At the location of the maximum likelihood estimate, it is close to zero. This area of the parameter space corresponds to a trough in the support curve. Calculating the confidence we can have in theta hat amounts to identifying whether this trough is wide or narrow. Indeed, if the maximum is shallow, like on the left, this means that there are many nearby values with a similar log likelihood. Hence, the uncertainty of the maximum likelihood is high. This case is indicated by a score that varies slowly around the maximum likelihood estimate. Conversely, if the maximum is narrow, like on the right, the absolute score for nearby values of theta hat quickly become much different from zero, and the estimate theta hat is more precise. Therefore, taking the derivative of the score, that is the second derivative of the log likelihood, gives a metric for the precision of the maximum likelihood estimate, as shown on these figures for two situations with higher precision in light blue or lower precision in dark blue. On the left, we see the graph of minus the log likelihood in the parameter space. In the middle is the graph of minus the first derivative of the log likelihood or score function. And on the right, the graph of minus the second derivative or Fisher information. The level reached by this curve at the maximum likelihood estimate is the observed Fisher information, and we see that it is higher for the light blue curve, which corresponds to the more narrow likelihood maximum. Again, this graphical example is in one dimension, but the parameter space is usually multidimensional, which is why the Fisher information is a matrix, which gives as diagonal and off-diagonal terms the precision of the maximum likelihood estimate when changing each parameter value separately or together. Because the log likelihood cannot be calculated in closed form, the same applies to the Fisher information matrix. Two different methods are available in monoliths for the calculation of the Fisher information matrix, by linearization or by stochastic approximation. The linearization method is faster and also applies to the task estimating the log likelihood. However, stochastic approximation gives more accurate results. Another video will cover the linearization method. I will now explain the main steps of the stochastic approximation. In the next slide, I will use this more compact notation for the observed Fisher information matrix, where the observed likelihood is detailed as the probability distribution function of the observed data given the population parameter estimate. Using the Lewis missing information principle, the Fisher information matrix can be decomposed as a combination of conditional expectations based on the first and second derivatives of the log likelihood. On this slide, I call them D, J, and delta. Each of these conditional expectations can be estimated by a Monte Carlo procedure. The main steps of this method are the following. At each iteration k, we generate individual parameters psi I from the individual conditional distributions, where psi I are the individual parameters for the individual I, theta hat are the estimated population parameters, and yi the data for individual I. Notice that this is also what is done by the task conditional distribution, as explained in the dedicated video, whose link appears on the top. This means that if the task conditional distribution has been run before the task standard errors, the first iterations are very fast because Monolix reuses the individual parameters sampled during that task. Once we have at least 50 sets of individual parameters, we compute the variables dk, jk, and delta k. You can recognize inside the sums similar terms than inside the conditional expectations that are composed of the first and second derivatives of the complete likelihood. These variables approximate the conditional expectations d, j, and delta with averages, and they can be either calculated with closed form for parameters with variability or with finite differences for parameters without variability for which there is no closed form expression. The finite differences imply calculating the model predictions for the estimated parameter values, but also values slightly larger and slightly smaller. In rare cases, this might produce numerical errors because of extreme values. The calculation then stops with this error message. This means that your model prediction is very sensitive to some parameter values, maybe due to some mistake in your structural model. After computing dk, jk, and delta k, these variables are used to update the estimate HK of the Fisher information matrix defined here. Finally, this estimate is inverted to get an estimate of the variance-covariance matrix of the parameters. The matrix may be difficult to invert if it is not well estimated or poorly conditioned, which can happen if there are correlations between parameter estimates. If the inversion succeeds, the procedure stops here. If the inversion fails, which means that the variance-covariance matrix contains 9 values, another iteration is done, and so on, until the matrix can be properly estimated. A maximum number of iterations is defined in the settings of the task. Therefore, by default, the stochastic approximation stops at most at 200 iterations, even if the matrix could not be inverted. In that case, Monolix gives a warning in the scenario report. There is also a minimum number of iterations, which, as I already mentioned, is 50. Once the Fisher information matrix has been estimated, Monolix derives not only the variance-covariance matrix in Gaussian space, that is, on the transformed normally distributed parameters, but also the variance-covariance matrix for the untransformed parameters using the Jacobian J. The standard errors for the parameter estimates correspond to the square roots of the diagonal elements of this matrix. And the matrix of correlations between the estimates is given with this formula. These are the results of the task shown in the interface of Monolix. The correlation matrix of the estimates is useful to check that the model is not overparameterized. To know more about how to interpret this matrix, you can watch our feature of the week video number 32. As I have mentioned, if the maximum number of iterations for the task is reached before the Fisher information matrix can be inverted, the task stops with the last estimate. The inversion then produces NAND in the correlation matrix and in the standard errors, as on this example. Notice that Monolix displays a warning below the correlation matrix. NANDs as standard errors can be seen as very large standard errors. They indicate that the model is too complex or poorly identifiable. In addition to the results in the interface, the variance-covariance matrix is also outputted as a file in the results folder. Finally, when a Monolix project is exported into Simulix, it is a variance-covariance matrix in Gaussian space that corresponds to the uncertainty matrix shown in Simulix, as on this example. It enables to sample new population parameters in the Gaussian space and propagate the uncertainty that we have on population parameters to the simulations. The sampled values are then converted to the non-Gaussian space. Getting the uncertainty of your population parameters is almost as important as estimating them. You are probably used to checking standard errors and correlation metrics to diagnose your model. Now you know how monoliths compute these matrices via the Fisher information matrix using stochastic approximation. To learn more about other monolith algorithms and how they work in detail, have a look at this playlist. See you next week for another video.